Hi, it's Mr. Sato. Let's talk about World War I and how it gave birth to modernism. World War I, what people at the time called the Great War, changed everything. It was a huge war between 7/8 of the world's population organized into two coalitions, the Allies and the Central Powers. Here's a list. The war broke out in 1914 and ended in 1918, and during those 4 years, 9 million soldiers were killed. The U.S. joined the war 3 years after it began. Before World War I, social and artistic change were already beginning to happen. But for most people, life had become safe and predictable. Literature and art followed certain widely accepted rules and conventions. But World War I, the Great War, some people called it the war to end all wars, because it was so horrible that surely no one would ever fight a war again, oh, if only, was a game changer, what's called a paradigm shift, a profound change in the way people saw the world and what it meant to be a human being in this world. In previous European wars, fighting was kind of orderly and had a personal man-against-man sort of dignity. And by the way, there weren't any female soldiers at that time. So an enemy soldier saw you, put you in his sights, and fired a single bullet that killed you. He chose you. You, an individual, were killed by an individual. And soldiers who died this way were worshipped as heroes. Boys grew up with unrealistic ideas about honor and valor, and those boys grew up to be young men who enthusiastically went off to fight in World War I. People actually cheered when war was declared. This drawing is a copy of a photograph of men in Paris marching to the enlistment office to sign up. Don't they look happy? When they got to the actual battlefield, their romantic ideas about warfare were blown to pieces. In 1914, the Industrial Revolution had produced nightmarish weapons, like the tank, a giant clanking metal monster that moved slowly across the battlefield, crushing people and firing explosive shells. No one had ever imagined anything like the tank. Soldiers ran away screaming. And then there was the artillery, big guns on wheels that fired explosive shells from miles away. Some of them were huge. Look at the size of this shell. Artillery probably killed more people than all the guns and bombs put together. So no one personally killed you. You were killed by someone who calculated the parabola correctly. You never saw him, and he never saw you. You were killed by mathematics. The most horrible weapon of the war was chlorine gas. Some called it mustard gas. Sometimes it was loaded into artillery shells. Other times, enemy soldiers would bring out drums of chlorine when the wind was blowing in your direction and push them over. The liquid would turn into a heavier-than-air fog that rose up and drifted across the battlefield and poured down into your trench. If you knew it was coming, you would put on your gas mask, which would save your life. They made people look like giant insects. But if you didn't put one on, you died a horrible, painful death, with the gas blinding you and burning your lungs. Later, an even deadlier gas would be used. Chemical warfare is now banned under international law. Unfortunately, that didn't stop the leaders of Iraq in 1988 or Syria in the 2010s. Airplanes and zeppelins had been invented by then. At first, pilots would do reconnaissance so that their soldiers could aim their artillery correctly. But pretty soon, they figured out how to drop bombs from the sky onto enemy troops. Submarines had been invented by then, too, but also depth charges that would destroy them. Machine guns had been invented that could kill 20, 30, 40 men in seconds, and they were especially lethal given the outdated and frankly stupid military tactics which involved huge numbers of men charging across the battlefield with bayonets, which are just knives attached to the ends of their rifles. Many times they were told not to put any bullets in their guns because they might shoot their own countrymen by accident. They were totally unprotected and died in row after row. Dead bodies were stacked alongside the roads like lumber and then buried in mass graves. What doesn't get talked about too much is disease. Medical science at the time was primitive compared to now. Tons of people died from infected wounds and typhoid fever. Many soldiers had to have their feet amputated due to something called trench foot. There was no heroism or glory in dying of a bacterial infection or diarrhea. There's no dignity in dying of dysentery. It isn't that World War I was more horrible than war today. Now, we know how horrible war is, and we have some idea what to expect. For unprepared young men in 1914, it felt like the world had been turned upside down and descended into hell. It was the most horrible thing the world had ever seen, and soldiers began to lose their minds. This literally wasn't what they signed up for. They developed forms of mental illness that came to be called shell shock, to make it sound like a physical phenomenon that doctors could understand and treat. But psychology was still in its infancy. People were just starting to hear about Sigmund Freud and something called the subconscious mind. But doctors didn't know what to do with these poor men who developed blindness, even though their eyes were fine, and crippling spasms and twitches that were basically the subconscious mind saying, "No, you are definitely not going back there. I'll make it so you can't go back." At night, they'd wake up screaming and try to crawl under the bed. Today, we'd call it severe PTSD. What does this all have to do with art and literature? Well, after the war was over, society couldn't go back to a world where everyone understood the rules and everything made sense. They'd seen the world go mad. Rules were no longer rules, and art always reflects the society that produces it, so artists began making art that made no sense. It was a movement called Dada. They described it as anti-art. They wrote poems of nonsense, like this one. This has been translated into English, but it didn't make any more sense in French. And they painted pictures that were nightmarish and frightening to look at. They rejected reason and logic, and instead embraced chaos, and put that chaos into their art. For example, Marcel Duchamp bought a urinal and entered it in a sculpture contest. He called it Fountain. It made you ask, well, why isn't that sculpture? What exactly makes something art? Dada was shocking at the time, but in my opinion, it was also kind of fun. This was the birth of modernism, a mosaic of new and unsettling artistic movements that was born when society was shattered into 1,000 pieces in the Great War. If you want to understand modernism, you have to understand World War I. Please leave comments below in the comment section. This video is a preface to a series of videos on modernism. I encourage you to check those out.